Parents are requested to please drop in their CNIC copy together with a photograph and with your registration number at the desk arranged by the institute outside this room. So please do favor ICAP and yourself and make your cards as early as possible. Now I would like to invite Mr. Adnan Mufti to please come and give his remaining part of his presentation.
Next. This was all about the sales tax. Now we can quickly look into certain areas in the excise net that are proposed to be changed. The first one is the adjustment area. Section 6 of the Excise Act provides that the credit of excise duty paid can only be availed if the registered person holds a valid proof to the effect that he has paid the price of goods and that he has recovered. Both ends needs to be met. Whereas in the case of the special excise duty, the other part is missing. One part is there that it should have been paid, but the onward recovery is missing. So there appears to be a conflicting position vis-a-vis the adjustment on the federal excise side and the adjustment on the special excise duty side. On the top of it, we understand that federal excise law as of today is being brought more and more closer to the sales tax regime. So in line with that, it is suggested that both the federal excise duty and the special excise duty, their credits should be made available, adjustable on accrual basis in line with Section 7 of the Sales Tax Act and the condition, mandatory condition of recovering the sale proceeds and the duty on account of on the federal excise side should be abolished. Next. Then the second area requiring modification and immediate recognition of the revenue authorities is the criteria. The federal excise duty is adjustable on a direct input basis, meaning thereby all the inputs which are part of the integral part of the goods that are being manufactured are adjustable. Whereas the special excise duty as it stands in SRO 655 is on industrial inputs. Now this term basically has not been defined, and resulting there is an ongoing litigation has already been started as to what constitute the industrial inputs, whether it is the same criteria as given in section 6 or not. So this needs to be addressed, and one would in the absence of any definition, one would construe as if it would cover the machinery, the spare parts, the stores, equipment, etc., etc. So we propose that this particular definition should be clearly specified under the law and the SRO. Next. Special excise duty on plant and machinery. We understand the basic all the items that are zero rated for sales tax purposes or for customs purposes are exempt from special excise duty as well. However, there are certain exceptions, and the chunk of duty that accrues to the government on these accounts is huge. For example, import or acquisition of plant and machinery is not specifically zero rated or exempt from SED. And of course, as I just mentioned in the previous slide, there is a lack of clarity as to whether it is adjustable or not. So we recommend that capital items should be exempted from SED as in line with the intent of section 3A of the act. Therefore we propose amendments in SRO 655 and SRO 615 to provide duty exemption on acquisition of plant and machinery. Next. Thode time pehle banks ko withholding agent banaya gaya hai for collection of excise duty on franchise, technical fee and royalty. ये सब excise law में एक ही definition से cover की जाते हैं. There is a rule 43A(7) which says that if the bank is not satisfied that duty on the remittance of royalty or technical fee or franchise fee is not paid by the remitter, then it is authorized to withheld the amount from the remittance and remit the balance and pay the differential to the government. Now, what is franchise basically? It is still a vague position as of today. What is happening? कि बैंक हर रेमिटेंस को वर्चुअली जो है वो या तो एक्स रॉयल्टी या टेक्निकल फी या फ्रेंचाइज फी की अकाउंट में क्लासिफाई करते हैं एंड दे कंपेल एंड प्रेशराइज द रेमिटर टू इन फैक्ट टू फॉर पेमेंट ऑफ द ड्यूटी और अदरवाइज दे ट्राई टू विदहोल्ड ड्यूटी इन मेनी इंस्टांसेस दे हैव डन इट एंड देयर वर केसेस एस्टैब्लिश्ड एंड नेगोशिएशंस एंड देन दैट वर रिवर्स्ड. So in view of the practical difficulties being faced by both the banks and the customers, it is proposed that a mechanism should be in place. Ye proper hona chahiye ki banks kya cheez examine karenge, kya cheez examine nahi karenge, whether the contract would need to be examined, whether the negotiation terms would need to be examined before deducting duty on any remittance. Next. Now we can move on to certain areas which requires modification in the draft value added tax, the Federal Value Added Tax Act 2010. Because at the policy level there are many things that are being discussed. I hope Asrar Saab would also enlighten us with the developments that are ongoing. There are various zero ratings that or exemptions that have been withdrawn, the tax net has been broadened to a great extent. But because of these policy matters and due to the positive time, we will just discuss the micro issues that in our opinion are likely to emerge if this draft is accepted or put in place in the present shape. The first thing is the registered person. The draft act defines a registered person as the one who is actually registered, who is liable to be registered. Jin logon ne फर्दर टैक्स जो सेल्स टैक्स 31A के तहत इशू किया गया था उसमें फर्दर टैक्स के का ज़माना देखा है वो इस बात को जानते हैं कि ये एक बहुत बड़ी एनोमली थी जो बाद में बेनतहा लिटिगेशन में कन्वर्ट हुई. उस वक्त भी लॉ की जो सेक्शन 225 सेल्स टैक्स एक्ट का वो रजिस्टर्ड पर्सन की डेफिनेशन एक्जैक्टली यही करता था, द पर्सन हु इज रजिस्टर्ड और लाइबल टू बी रजिस्टर्ड. और उसमें हुआ ये था कि जो लोग भी एक्चुअली देवर लाइबल टू बी रजिस्टर्ड एंड देवर इवेडिंग रजिस्ट्रेशन वो लिटिगेशन में चले गए एंड द डिमांडेड इक्वल ट्रीटमेंट एज दैट ऑफ अ रजिस्टर्ड पर्सन ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ दिस वेग डेफिनेशन. नाउ वी सी दैट द सेम डेफिनेशन इज प्रोपोज इन द फेडरल वैट एक्ट विच इन आर व्यू इज अ डेंजरस पोजिशन एंड इट कुड लीड टू अ सिमिलर आइडेंटिकल सॉर्ट ऑफ लिटिगेशन और क्वेरीज एंड एक्सेट्रा एक्सेट्रा. देयरफॉर वी प्रोपोज दैट डेफिनेशन मे बी अमेंडेड एंड registration registered status should only be considered for a person who is actually registered by way of an actual registration certificate or a provisional registration certificate which we actually requested in the preceding slides. Next, supply of goods. Again, this is the old concept to which we are now referring to. There was the section 244 of the Sales Tax Act that contained it defined the time of supply to be the earliest of two events. Either there is a delivery of goods or there is a receipt of advance from the customers. Now the federal VAT has in fact enlarged the proposition. It now defines as the time of supply is the time when the goods are delivered or the goods are made available to the recipient or the invoice issued और पार्ट पेमेंट इज रिसीव्ड. तो ये बहुत अरसे बाद जो है इसको जाके अकाउंटिंग टर्म्स पे जाकर हम जो है वो इन लाइन विद द अकाउंटिंग स्टैंडर्ड्स उसको डिलीवरी ऑफ गुड्स के ऊपर टाइम ऑफ सप्लाई को क्लासिफाई किया गया था. अब हम फिर उस तरफ जा रहे हैं, देयर इज अ नीड टू चेक दिस अप फ्रंट, अदरवाइज वही होगा जो होता रहा है कि कौन सी पेमेंट लायबल टू टैक्स है, कौन सी नहीं है, पार्शल है, एडवांस है, सिक्योरिटी डिपॉजिट है, एक्सेट्रा एक्सेट्रा. सो वी प्रोपोज दैट इट शुड बी मेड the time of supply should be classified as the time when the goods are delivered and not otherwise, to avoid the reporting or accounting and treatment errors. Next, CNSF buyer. Section 49, again ye ek aur hum usi cheez ko repeat kar rahe hain. Pichle budget mein ye propose kiya gaya tha ki har registered person before issuing invoice must mention the CNIC of the unregistered buyer. हुआ क्या, बिजनेस कम्युनिटी ने इस पर श्योर किया दैट हैड टू बी रिवर्स बैक.